Hello friends, welcome to my channel. In this lecture we are going to focus on the inheritance concepts in Java. So let us see the first program to write a Java program to implement multi-level inheritance by applying the various access controls to its data members and methods. Let us see how to write the Java program to implement this multi-level inheritance. As we know that when we talk about multi-level inheritance, we will be having more than one classes, and in that one class we will make it as a template where all the common attribute of the class will be available, and rest of the classes are going to extend that class, and if required they can even add some more instance variables for that. So let us see how to write a program which will implement the concept of multi-level inheritance, right? And meanwhile we are also going to apply some various access controls to its data members and methods. So in this problem scenario, we had taken a class as a student, and as we all know, there are two common attributes which every student will have, that is a roll number and a name, and we are given the access specifier as a private for both, so that other classes cannot access this particular data members, right? And we also have a class called a scanner which will accept the input from the user, and we have system.in, where system is a class, and we can see that in is an input stream, that means it reads the sequence of data from the user, right? And we have two methods in this class student. They are get roll number and the put roll number. So get roll number will accept the input from the user, and put roll number will simply display the roll number and the name of an appropriate user, right? So now, as you also see that there are some exception handling mechanism been written in the program. As you can see, there is a try and catch block, right? So I'll let you know why I wrote this try and catch block here. First let us see to print a statement like enter your USN. So whenever it prompts an any student to enter their USN, so via scanner object dot nextInt method, I'm going to accept the input, and meanwhile I'm going to store it in a variable roll number. Same options I am going to do it here, like enter your name and store that in a name variable here, right? So if for example invalid data is entered, as you can see that enter your USN is an integer data type, right? So what if I add any string or any alphabets? So it will throw an exception for you. Exception is an error, right? And this exception should be handled, right? So how do you handle it? Java provides a special mechanism called as exception handling mechanism via try and catch. So what we do means the code, the set of instructions, we are going to write it in a try block, and if there is any error occurs, it will throw it in a catch block. The catch block will catch all the errors and it will handle there and there. So we have written here the superclass of all the exception is exception, and you can see there is an object being created, E, right? So what we can do is we can directly print the statement like invalid data, and if you do not want to proceed further, you can write a statement system.exit of 0, and it will display a message called as program terminated. This will only happen when there is an invalid data entered, else it will go further. Similarly, you have another method called put roll number, which will simply accept the roll number by the get roll number and it will print it. So this method will only print the roll number and the name of the student. Now we have a class called as marks, right? And it will extend the student. This is the concept of inheritance. So this is a subclass, this is a superclass. Subclass can access all the data members and methods of the superclass via keyword called as extends. And here we have three variables, as you can see, m1, m2 and m3, right? So now we are going to write some method called as get marks, as you can see, and there is also a method called put marks. So get marks will accept the marks from the user, like enter the marks 1. The same operation how we did it in class, right? The same operation we are going to do it here, accept and store it in a variable m1, m2 and m3. And if there is any exception being caught, because all the marks are integer, if there is any alphabet being entered, it will terminate your application there and there, right? And if everything goes successful, then it will print all your marks. And there is one more class called a result, which will extend the class called marks. And it has a one instance variable called total and a one method called display. This will directly add up all the marks what you entered, and it will compute and store the result in the total. And that total marks will be displayed at the end, right? So as you can see that this M1, M2, M3, it is not been declared in the class result. But since result is extending marks, I can access all the data members of the marks class, right? So this is how it happens. So this concept is called as multi-level inheritance. Finally, we need to write a main method. For that, we need to have a main class, and you can see that the access specifier what been given is public, right? Only for the main class we can give the access specifier as public. If there are multiple classes, you cannot give multiple public classes. So for example, if I write public here, it will throw an error for me, right? So we can't write like this. As you can see, the error has occurred. So what that error says, the public type result may be defined in its own file. So if there are many class files, please make sure that you are going to write the public access specifier only for the main class, not for other class where the main method resides, right? So now we have a main method, and after that we would like to create an object for a result class, that is R. Then via that object we are going to access the methods. There are how many methods? We have 5 methods, like roll number, getting the roll number, marks, again to display the roll number and marks, and finally to display your computed answer. This is the program what we wrote. Let us see the demonstration first. So I executed the code here. So it is asking for enter your USN. I will just type 100 is my USN. After that it is asking for the name. I'll just write Amar. And asking for the marks 1, I'll write 20. Marks 2, it's 10. And marks 3 is again 20 or 25. Okay. So everything is properly written. So the roll number, it will display all the detail, roll number, name, marks 1, marks 2, marks 3, and the total marks is being computed, that is 55. Right? This is a simple program which will demonstrate the concept of multi-level. Let me show you another program which adds more fields into the in the extended classes. Let me take the question first. Here we would like to design a super class called as staff, right? Super class is a main class, right? It's a template. So super class called as staff with the details as staff ID, name, phone number and salary. That means each and every staff will have their own ID, name, phone number and salary, right? But rest of the information will not be common in all the faculties or all the staff. So what they are asking here, they are asking to extend this class by writing 3 subclasses. That means 3 more subclasses I need to create, like teaching, technical and contract. So teaching will have 2 more extra fields like domain and publications. Technical will have 1 extra field, skills, and contract will have 1 extra field, period. Right? Now we need to write a Java program to read and display at least 3 staff objects of all 3 categories. That means for each category they are asking us to create a 3 objects, right? So we can, in my earlier lecture you had seen that if there is more than one object to be created dynamically, it's better to use an array, right? We can use it in a for loop and dynamically we can handle all these things, right? So in this case also I had done the same thing. So let me show you the program first. Let us see the main class, that is staff. You can see here there is a staff ID, name is of type string, phone number type long, and there is a salary of type float, right? These are the 4 variables they had asked, which is common in a class staff. Now as you can see that the values for each staff ID, name, phone number and salary will vary for each and every staff, right? So we need to make use of a parameterized constructor, right? If null constructor is been used, then the same value will be applied for all the objects, right? To avoid that, we need to use a parameterized constructor. So what is the constructor here? Staff is a constructor. Why? Because it has the same name as that of the class. And how many parameters has been passed here? Staff ID, name, phone number and salary, right? As you can see that the particular local variables what has been passed is same as that of the instance variable here. In this case, it's good to use a this keyword. If this keyword is not been used, it will be in a confused state, right? So it will give a warning to the user, the assignment to a variable staff ID has no effect. That is the reason it's better to use this keyword like this. Or else you can even change the name of this. For example, if I add only ID here, right, then I can use ID over here and no need to use this in this case because both are different. This will work for you, right? So if you are using the same option, if you are using the same option here, staff ID, and here also staff ID, then always make use of this keyword. Actually, this keyword is a reference variable which refers to the current object of that class, right? Current object of the current class, right? So this is how we initialize everything. So constructor is always used to initialize all the data members of that class. This is how we do that. Then finally, we will close it. So what is there in the class staff? We have only the instance variable and a parameterized constructor. So whatever you pass the value here, that will get stored in the instance variable so that you can use it later when you are going to extend this class, right? Now they had asked us for three subclasses, right? Teaching, technical and contract. So first we'll focus on teaching classes, and you can see the concept what I used for inheritance is extends. So this is also a multi-level inheritance. Teaching extends staff here, and we have two extra variables called as domain and publications. Now every staff should have those four attributes to be common, which are those staff ID, name, phone number and salary. Apart from that, if you require two more fields, you can do so by extending. But one thing you can focus here, you need not to write that again in the particular, you need not initialize that particular thing in the constructor. As you can see here, I written staff ID, name, phone number, salary. How can I write this? Because I had extended the class called staff. Along with that, two other fields also been written as a parameter. Now you can see here, instead of writing everything like this dot, like this, this dot staff ID equals staff ID, this dot name equal name, I need not write it again and again. What I will do is I will use a keyword called super, right? Super will always point to the super class, which is a super class for the class teaching. It is the staff class. So if you write super staff ID, name, phone and salary, you need not initialize it here because already you have done that job in your super class called staff. So you just need to write this one statement, and rest of the things you have to do as it is, right? So this dot domain equal domain, this dot publication equal to publication. So your constructor got over here. Now we are going to write one small method called display, which will simply display the inputs what you have entered, like staff ID, name, phone number, salary, domain and publication. As you can see, in between had given some tab space, so slash t is the command for that. Hope you understand. The same will apply for technical and contract here. As you can see, technical we have an extra field called skills. The same operation we do, we here also we have parameterized constructor, and staff ID, name, phone number, salary is taken from the extended class, and we had initialized only the skills. Here also we have a method called as display, and same operation will be applied also for the contract. We are only period is the extra field over here. Same operation will be done. Now we'll have a main class, that is staff detail. We have a public static void main, and this class only can be given as public. Other classes cannot be given, right? Now what they asked us, at least three objects has to be created. So I told the maximum object what you can create is 10. So this is an array of object. As you can see, staff, yes, array. So it's an array of objects, right? Memory allocation has been given via new, and the size of that particular objects what you can create for a class staff is 10 at the max. So there is a variable called yes of type boolean. By default it is given with true, and we have a choice. So what we are doing here is we will give like a menu like option like teaching, technical, contract and exit. So you can choose a number like which you would like to enter the details. Like if few people would like to enter the detail for teaching, they can enter as 1, else they can enter as 2, 3 or 4, right? So to do that, we need, again we need a class called a scanner which will accept the input from the user. So we will use do while loop because I want at least once to display this kind of message. Later on, based on the user's input, we will decide what to be given as a output, right? So do while block we are using. So we can see that the first statement what it's going to print is teaching, technical, contract and exit. And also it will ask to enter your choice, right? So this will be displayed in the new line, as you can see slash and is being given here. Now whatever you accept, whatever you enter, for example if you enter 1, that 1 will be there in the choice. And I'd use a switch case statements here. So based on the choice what you selected, that will be, that instruction is going to get executed. So for example if you select 1, case 1 will go, and you have the first line, enter the number of teaching staff data. That means how many teaching staff details you need to create. That means how many objects you would like to create for a teaching staff details, right? So whatever you enter the number, that will be stored in N. So this is used for looping later on, because if you tell 2, then 2 times this entire questions will be asked to you. If you say 1, only 1 time it will be asked, right? And it will later on, based on your number, it will ask you to enter the teaching staff details. So you have to put that N in the loop here, starting from 0, because the array index value starts from 0 up to N, and keep on incrementing the value. Here also you can see I'd use a try catch block. I hope you understand why, because here also if you try to add any invalid data, automatically it will handle, or else JVM will throw an exception for you there and there, right? So once you enter the choice, it will ask you for staff ID, staff name, phone number, salary, domain, publication. And you can see that this is used to create an object here. As you can see, S of I. So it is at the beginning, it is S of 0. It's the first object. Memory allocation has been given to the constructor here. And this is the constructor, what you use, parameterized constructor. So whatever value passed, no, all this value will be passed as an argument here. All this value will be passed as an argument here. Right? Any error occurred, it will get caught in the catch block. And finally it is going to display. So this is just a header, and below the header with the number of items you choose, based on that it is going to call a display method. So as you can see here, why I wrote like this. So you can see here, it's very clearly been given over here that I did typecasting over there. Hope you can see that. So this is a typecasting. So what happens if I don't do? So let me remove this as of now. What happens if I write only S of I dot display? As you can see, display method is common in the stuff, right? Every method, every particular class, it has a method called a display. Now Java will get a confusion that which method to call it. So you have to typecast that particular object. So how do you do that? Java will, it will show you some suggestion that either you have to create a method display in the type staff, since you extended the class, or else you need to cast it. And when we click on this casting, it will give you three options like teaching, technical and contract, because this display method is available in all these three classes. So as of now, I want what is displayed in the, what is written in the teaching class, that has to be displayed. So I'll select teaching. So this is called as typecasting here, this much. We have typecasted it, and in this particular class teaching, that particular object is going to call the method called a display, and that whatever instruction is written within display method, that will get printed out, right? After that you can break the statement. Same operations will go for your technical stuff. Here what is there? Here instead of domain and publication, we had asked salary, we had asked only one field called skills, and same operation has been done. As you can see, the values will change here. Instead of domain and publication, we are given only skills. And what is the typecasting we had applied here? Technical. Before it was teaching. Now here, technical. And the final class is contract. Here also same operation will be applied. Same thing. Only thing is, instead of skills we have period. Rest all are same, and you can see the typecasting we had used is contract. Right? So if there is any invalid choice, like apart from 4 you had used, then it will throw a message called as invalid choice, or else it will close and program will get terminated, right? So this is the program. So let us execute this. Okay, let me execute. As you can see here, it is prompting for user to accept any one choice, right? Teaching, technical, contract, and let me put that 1. So it is asking enter the number of teaching staff detail. Let me put 2. It is asking for staff ID. Let me put 100. Staff name Ajay. Phone number. Let me put 15-digit number. Random numbers. And salary 45,000. Domain. Let me put Java. And it is asking for publication count. Let me put 4. Again, it is asking for the staff ID. Let me put 200. Staff name Rahul. Phone number, some random number. Salary 50,000. Domain, let me put C++. Publication, let me put 6. Now you can see the results are displayed here for the every staff ID, name, phone number, salary, domain, and publication. Now we can go for another choice. Here 2 objects been created and 2 results has been displayed, right? If I select option 2, then it will ask for the technical staff details. Enter the number of technical. Let me enter it only 1 detail. So staff ID, as you can see, staff ID will always take integer value. What happens if I put any alphabet? So what will happen? That error has been occurred. So it has been caught in the catch block. In the catch block, you seen that invalid data entered message was been written, and I will directly terminate the program so that it doesn't go further. If it goes further, what happens means garbage value get displayed, or else the default value will get displayed, right? Which is not professional to be displayed. So we have terminated the application there and there whenever you try to add a invalid data, right? So thanks for watching. Happy learning, guys.